Good morning, church, and happy Father's Day to all the dads that are participating in our worship this morning. I want to welcome you, our members, and if you're our member this morning, I want to encourage you to like and share this post on Facebook. I also want to welcome our guests, whether you're watching us on Facebook, and we'd love for you to like and share this post as well. But I want to encourage you or welcome you, our guests, whether you're watching us through Facebook or our YouTube channel, or you're watching through our website. We began in-person services this morning at 8 o'clock, 9:30, and 11 o'clock. And if you are a guest especially, we know a lot of our members aren't quite ready to come back, and some of our guests aren't quite ready to come back to in-person services either. But if you're our guest and maybe you've happened upon our website or you've been invited to our Facebook post by a friend, I would encourage you to consider when you're ready to come to one of our in-person services. Now the best way to do that, to make sure to know which one to attend, is to contact the church office. You can do that by going to our website, centralchurchofchristtopeka.com. So I'm going to encourage you to do that and find out which service and let us know which one you're coming to. That way we can make sure we have a place just for you. I want to encourage you, if you haven't already, gather up your communion supplies, grab your Bible, and also grab a pen and a piece of paper or a notepad. Last Sunday, we completed a 9-week sermon series from Colossians 3, 1 through 17, The Resurrected Life. And throughout that series, from the very beginning, I've encouraged us to memorize Colossians 3, 1 through 17. Now, I've said we would recite it this morning, but because of time, we're only going to recite the first four verses. So I want to encourage you to recite the first four verses with me this morning. Since you have been raised with Christ, set your heart on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things, for you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, you also will appear with Him in glory. Let's pray together. O God, empty us of angry judgments and aching disappointments and anxious trying, and breathe into us something like quietness and confidence, that the lion and the lamb in us may lie down together and be led by a trust as straightforward as a little child. Catch our pride and doubt off guard, that at least for the moment we may sense your presence and your caring, and be surprised by a sudden joy rising in us now to sustain us in the coming then. In the name of Jesus, we offer this prayer. Amen. I forgot to invite the boys and girls, sixth grade and below, down front, but if they're not close to the device, if they could hurry on down, that would be awesome. I wanted to share a children's message. As a matter of fact, I want to read a book today. When I was sharing with Aaron Partlow and telling him what I was going to be preaching on today, he said, "Oh, I've got the perfect book for you to read." And it's entitled Good, Good Father for Little Ones. And so I want to read that. What is a good, good father like? Like a king who is fair and kind. He rules with your very best in mind. Yeah, I don't know if you can see that picture, but I'll try to show the pictures very quickly. Like a warrior who is strong and brave, he protects you when you are afraid. Like a teacher who helps you learn and grow, he teaches you what you need to know. Like a doctor, when you have the achoos, he gives you medicine and fixes boo-boos. Like a farmer planting seeds, he grows the yummy food you need. Like a musician whose songs make you wiggle, he loves to see you dance and giggle. Like a friend who is always near, he cheerfully lends a listening ear. Like a leader who takes command, he shows you good things he has planned. Like a daddy with a tender heart, he forgives you when you need a fresh start. a king, a musician, a friend, a warrior, a good, good father is all these things and more. No matter what you say or do, a good, good father never stops loving you. Boys and girls, this morning, I want you to know that I believe that your dad, your fathers, do the best they can be to be a good father. They do the best they can. But like me, as a father, and now as a grandfather, I'm not perfect. And nor is your father perfect, your dad perfect. But I want you to know that the good, good father that we just read about, God is the perfect father. And so what I want you to know this morning, what I want to encourage you to do this morning, is I want to encourage you to applaud your dad when he is as God-like as he can be. When your dad acts like the good, good father, when he acts like God, who is his role model for a father, I want you to applaud your dad. Let's talk to God in prayer. Father, I want to thank you for the fact that we have had our fathers in our lives. But Father, I pray that we might learn as dads, and I pray, Father, that we might even learn as children that the perfect father is you. And I pray, Father, that we will model as fathers and that we will look towards your model as a father. Thank you so much for all of these boys and girls. Bless them as only you can and bless their relationship with their dads. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, boys and girls, I want to encourage you, it's Father's Day, and I want to encourage you to run back, jump on bed or jump on the couch with your dad, give them a great big hug, and let them know how much you love them. James Bryan Smith, in his book entitled The Good and Beautiful God, talks about a lectureship that he was giving on prayer. And after a day of lecturing, he comes to the end of the lecture and he begins to pray. He closes out the day in prayer. And he addresses God as our Father, our Heavenly Father. Not long after he finished, a young lady came up and she said, I want you to know that you had me all day as we talked about prayer until you address God as Father. You need to know that I just had an incredibly terrible father, and I cannot focus on, imagine that God being a father. I can't imagine that. And it's hard for me to focus on that. I need you to know that I've had similar experiences through the years. I've had, as I've provided spiritual guidance and spiritual counseling for folks through the years, I've had different individuals say to me, I can't imagine God as a father because I had such a terrible father. There's three facts I want you to know that I am aware of this morning. The first of all is some of us that are listening to and participating in this worship this morning have had a terrible or an absentee father. And for that, I'm extremely sorry. I'm sorry that happened to you. But the second thing that I need you to know, that none of us fathers, even if we were good fathers, or at least some thought we were good, and maybe our children thought we were good, we were not perfect fathers, myself included. But we have gathered this morning to worship the one truly perfect Father. God is the Father that all fathers should imitate. We learn what a father and a parent is, as far as that goes, by looking at God, not vice versa. We don't learn about what a good father is by looking at our fathers. We look at the perfect father, the good, good father that from the children's book that I read a few minutes ago. Jesus had a relationship with his father, with our father, our heavenly father, before the world ever began. And I would suggest today that we learn about our Heavenly Father from the Son who knows Him best. And this morning I want us to look at two prayers. And I think through those two prayers we will get a glimpse into who God is and who Jesus knew God the Father to be. The first we know as the Lord's Prayer, or maybe better put, the Model Prayer. Because there are a lot of different prayers that Jesus prayed, but the model prayer, the prayer that he suggested, that he taught to his disciples, and indirectly teaches to us. Let's say this prayer together, if you would, if you'd like to, or at least listen as I read this prayer. This then is how you should pray, from Matthew chapter 6. It's also found in Luke. But in Matthew chapter 6, this then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. I want you to know, and I'm just going to go ahead and tell you, the challenge for the week is to meditate on this prayer. I want to encourage you the rest of this week, I want to encourage you to meditate on this prayer. And here's what I believe we will find as we meditate on this prayer. That we're going to see that Jesus, through this prayer, revealed about His Father, that His Father, our Father, is nearby. He's holy. He's powerful. He's forgiving. And He's our protector. But there's another prayer I want us to consider from Mark chapter 14. Going a little farther, He fell. We're in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus will soon be arrested. He's just introduced the Lord's Supper. He's just participated in the Passover meal with His apostles. Going a little farther, He fell to the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from Him. Abba, Father, He said, everything is possible for You. Take this cup from Me, yet not what I will, but what You will. I want you to know that Abba, Father, is a term of intimacy. And I know that when I was younger, when I was a teenager, that I remember a different youth minister saying, well, this is like saying Daddy. And then I heard people often pray and almost pray irreverently using this term. Now, that's not the intent. The intent is intimacy, but not being casual. It's acknowledging that Abba, our God, Abba, Father, we have an intimate relationship with Him. But there's also, this term carries the idea of obedience. I want you to know that Jesus, in His anxiety, in His emotional agony over His impending physical suffering, sweats as drops of blood. And He is sharing this with the one He is most intimate with, His Father, and the one that He will do whatever He asks of Him. Whatever God the Father asks, that's how much Jesus trusts God. Your will, not mine, be done. God is the Father that all fathers should imitate. Again, this week, I want to challenge you to meditate on the model prayer from Matthew 6, 9 through 13, focusing on what you can learn about our perfect Father. I want to encourage you to do that. May you be blessed this week as you meditate on this passage and learn more about our perfect Father. Often as we gather around the table to remember Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, we focus on His physical sufferings. At least I know that I have done that in the past. And I think that's okay. I think that's important to do. But this morning, I want us to focus on the emotional agony and the trust in God expressed on Calvary by Jesus. I want us to, before the bread, I want us to read from Luke chapter 22, beginning of verse 39. Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and His disciples followed Him. On reaching the place, He said to them, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down and prayed, "Father, if You are willing, take this cup from Me, yet not My will, but Yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to Him and strengthened Him, and being in anguish, He prayed more earnestly, and His sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. When He rose from prayer and went back to the disciples, He found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. "Why are you sleeping?" He asked them. "Get up and pray so that you will not fall into temptation." Let's pray. our perfect Father, thank you for the precious gift of your Son. I cannot imagine the emotional agony and suffering Jesus experienced as he prayed in the garden. The agony and suffering he experienced because of our sins. As we partake of the bread, may we remember the agony and suffering experienced physically, emotionally, and spiritually as he died in our stead. In the name of our most trustful, in your most trustful Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Now a reading before the cup from John 19, 25 through 27. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home. Jesus, the perfect Son, cared for his blood, his mother, as he shed his blood on the cross for you and for me. Let's pray. Father, may we learn to care for our blood, our family, as Jesus cared for his. Jesus sacrificed his blood for the mother he cared for from the cross. Thank you. Jesus sacrificed his blood for his siblings, even though they had denied who he was. Thank you. Jesus gave his blood for us so we could become his blood, your blood, his relation through adoption. Thank you so much. In the name of our precious brother Jesus, we pray. Amen. This morning, as we close, I want to thank you for faithfully mailing your contributions or giving online. God's Spirit welling up in you and in us has caused us to be a generous church, enabling our congregation to continue to serve God even through challenging times. As we end this morning, I want to leave you with these words. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine on you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace.